brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Dear friends, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. There's a fun get-to-know-you question that goes like this. If you could invite 3 people, dead or alive, to a dinner party, who would you invite? It's a fun thing to think about. Who would you want to talk to? Who would make a good dinner party member that you would love to have there? And so on. Well, today is All Saints Sunday. It is an open dinner party kind of day, so to speak. But it isn't limited to 3 people. This is the day where the church remembers and calls to mind all the saints, and especially those who have gone on before us. It is a day where we pay attention to the ways that we are all at that dinner party together. Before we go any further, I want to define the word saint for our purposes. You might be thinking that a saint is an especially holy person. We do use the word that way commonly, and in some religious traditions, it more has that meaning. But in the Lutheran tradition, the saint is for anyone who is connected to Christ. The actual word saint, for those of you that get into word meaning kinds of things, it comes from a Greek word meaning holy ones. And that word derives from a Hebrew word meaning set apart for God's use. And so saints are holy ones who are set apart for God's use. And if you think about it, it is in baptism that we are all set apart for God's use as we are connected to Christ and claimed as children of God. And so it is the Lutheran understanding that all who are connected to Christ in baptism are saints. So if you are sitting here today and you have been baptized, there is no doubt you are a saint. So today, All Saints Day is actually for all of us. It is a day to celebrate all of us united in God's family, united as part of God's body in the world. But it's also true that traditionally on this day we place a special emphasis on those who have gone on before us. And as I shared in the announcement, so here those names read during the prayers of those from this congregation who have died since the last All Saints Day. I have been seeing the saints of Christ the King in action a lot lately. You just had your 60th anniversary celebration weekend. I heard the names of saints who have gone on before you. I heard the stories of their lives in this congregation and the impact of those lives on your lives. I heard the stories of the saints who founded this congregation. And I saw the living saints of Christ the King in action welcoming people, extending hospitality, cooking, serving, singing, worshiping, reminiscing, and enjoying one another. It's like we have all been at a giant dinner party. We literally, many of us, were at the ham dinner. But it extends also to worship. That is its own dinner party, too. I also was paying attention to the saints on Friday when we hosted Tom Lydia's memorial service. As family and friends gathered to give witness to his memory, I saw the Welka Bible study circle that Annie, Tom's widow, belongs to, come together to be the servers for the funeral service. I saw Tom's children carry on the legacy of their father in this world. And I witnessed the heartfelt and talented music of Tom's granddaughter, who poured out her heart and her faith through piano and song. I also heard of Tom's impact on lives in this congregation. And I thought back to the day that I sat beside him, and we talked about the anniversary, and he made mention of what a brave thing it was to start this congregation when this neighborhood was still way out on the edge of things. He reflected for me the bravery of the saints who had gone on before, and now he has joined those saints. As we think about this giant dinner party with all the saints, I want to call us back to that first reading from Isaiah. In it, we heard about God's banquet. I want to read it again as you imagine all the saints, present, and those who've gone on ahead. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, of rich food filled with marrow, of well-aged wine strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Now think about that dinner party. Now maybe your menu would be a little bit different than the one Isaiah laid out. That's fine. But as Isaiah wrote it in ancient times, those would have been foods of absolute abundance. This is not a cheap dinner party. This is not a dinner party where you try to figure out how to get by on very little. This is a dinner party of greatest abundance. And there are a couple of images I have in my mind to add to Isaiah's image. I invite you to think of the times where we bring food into this sanctuary space and even up into this chancel area and up near the altar. Of course, Holy Communion is one of those times. We have the elements on the altar. We will come forward today to receive those. Also, in some congregations, and maybe you have done this here, some congregations will gather like pantry food donations. Sometimes maybe on the Thanksgiving Eve service. I think it'd be cool if we did that. And you think about all the like canned goods and stuff piled up in front of the altar as this reminder of our own bounty that we extend to others who are in need. Another example, this one's pretty radical, so hang on. But it was a congregation that decided to start a food pantry ministry from their congregation. And the person organizing it felt very strongly that it needed to reflect the congregation's gathering for the Holy Meal of Communion. So they organized the food pantry so that they were giving away food right from the sanctuary. They even used the altar as a central table for holding food. Have no fear, I'm not going to suggest that one. I think I might rock the boat a bit if I did. But for fun, imagine the altar heaped with food to give away and people stretched out through the doors waiting for their turn to receive the food. even if we don't enact it in that way, it is an image to go with Isaiah's well-aged wines and rich food filled with marrow. It is God's abundance extending to all. Now, when we gather for Holy Communion, we are not just receiving God's holy meal, as precious as that is, but we are also communing with all the saints, those who have gone on before us and those who are here. Deacon Jess was telling me that she was taught that that's why in your traditional churches that have that half-circle altar rail, why it is a half-circle, because then the image is that it is the communion of saints that fills out the rest of the circle. I love that image. And I saw an image this year that made me think about how we are gathered as people here on earth and gathered with those who have gone on before us when we are in Holy Communion. I was not there, but it was a photo from the funeral of a pastor I have barely known, but she was young, she was in her 40s. She had hereditary heart disease and had a heart attack, but hit her head and had a brain bleed. And in trying to balance treating those two situations, in the end, she died. And she was a well-loved pastor in the Twin Cities, and her funeral needed to be held at the largest church there in the Twin Cities, Central Lutheran, if you know that space. And her casket went straight. Imagine if there's an altar rail making half of a square, and her casket was pointed that way, down the aisle. And then when it was time for the servers to line up for communion, they had them all line up before they served others, and they were served. And they were lined up all around this square. They were wearing the white albs, you call these things. Her casket had a white pall, a cloth that covers it, all of those garments to remind us of our baptism. And I looked and I saw Stephanie in the as a saint eternal, gathered with the saints still here on earth, lined up for communion. And there was that image of what happens. So today, when we gather for communion, I invite you to take a moment if you want that or need that. And I invite you to give each other time for that. If the person in front of you doesn't move right away, it's okay. Let's take a moment for that today. If there are some tears, that's fine. I already said mine. The opening hymn got me. So we have tears sometimes, and that's okay. If you go back to the passage from Isaiah or even the reading from Revelation, you'll notice something that I often skip past, and that is that God's peace, God's presence, is not something far off and away. It is something that comes to us. Did you notice that? Neither passage is about people going to God. It is about God coming to the earthly realm. And when God comes, he will swallow up death forever. He will wipe away the tears. Mourning and crying will be no more. The first things will have passed away. It is a glorious promise. It is something we look for, and it is a hope to which we cling. And if you look at the gospel passage, Jesus, too, is the one who comes. He didn't do things for Lazarus from afar. He came. Now, Lazarus' sisters wanted him there earlier, but Jesus was there to show and to enact the gift of resurrection and eternal communion. And so he came to Lazarus. He came, and with his words, he brought Lazarus from the tomb, and the community unbound Lazarus. Lazarus was restored to the communion of saints on earth for a while longer. Back to the dinner party image. Every successful dinner party needs a really good host. And for our journeys of faith, that is God. God is not only the one who comes to us, who brings the heavenly eternal realm into our midst, but God is the one who makes a seat for everyone and brings us all together, all of us. We are gathered into the communion of saints on this earth and with God in the church triumphant. Thanks be to God. Amen.